Mark the 3rd chapter, verse 1 through 5, and listen, this is a very familiar passage of scripture, so I pray that the familiarity of the text does not eliminate the revelation for tonight in this familiarity. Amen. Mark 3, verse 1 through 5, and he entered again into the synagogue, and there was a man which had a withered hand. And they watched him whether he would heal him on the Sabbath day, that they might accuse him. And he said unto the man which had the withered hand, stand forth. And he said unto them, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath day or to do evil, to save life or to kill? But they held their peace. And when he had looked around about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts, he said unto the man, stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored whole as the other. If you will, note that last verse, because, and he said unto the man, stretch forth your hand. And he stretched it out. After stretching out his hand, it was restored as the other. And he said, stretch out your hand. And after he stretched his hand, he received the blessing of restoration. Tonight I'm here to encourage somebody that's being stretched. I'm here to talk to someone that's being stretched and to assure you that there is a blessing in the stretch. There is a blessing in the stretch. Now, let's make this disclaimer. This message perhaps isn't for everybody doing this liberal and conventional. It's not here, but I'm here to minister to just the remnant that's been stretched in the last few years, that's been stretched in the last few months. I'm here to encourage someone that's encountered some breath taken moments. Perhaps the enemy had tried to convince you that that situation was about to break you down, but the enemy is not truthful. You are not at a breaking point in your life, but you're at a place of blessing. Don't get it confused. It's not about breaking, but it's about blessing. You might be troubled at this point on every hand, as 2 Corinthians 4 and 8 said, but we are troubled on every side. And when you look around at the things that are going on in our world, in the cosmos, yes, there are all kinds of things that we do not agree with and things that are troublesome in our lives. The misrepresentation of identity, the misrepresentation of family identity, the senseless shooting, the senseless crimes, the rate of increase in suicide. Yes, we are troubled on every side. And then there are the things that you can't even talk about, that no one knows. You're having the real people up in here, that no one knows you're going through. We're troubled on every side, 2 Corinthians 1:8, but we're not in distress. We are perplexed, but we're not in despair. We're persecuted, but not forsaken. We're cast down, but thank God we're not destroyed, because whatever is stretching me, there's a blessing in the stretch. There's a blessing. Somebody just scream stretch. Stretch, the word stretch from the Webster Dictionary, it means to be extended, to be forced, to be made to serve beyond your normal capacity. to serve beyond the proper limits that have been set for you, to be exerted in such an intensified manner until at some point you can become unrecognizable. But I believe that all of us that are being stretched at this time, that are being stretched beyond our own limits, that our faith is being tried to the max. And when God perfects that thing that concerned us, you're going to be blessed beyond measures. I just believe somebody screamed, blessed beyond measures. Blessed beyond measures. Y'all, you need to know the enemy, I promise you, has been trying to mess with me all day long. But I declare and I decree that I'm going to stretch my way through this particular thing. Yes. I believe that many of us who have been stretched beyond our own limitation, that God allowed you to go through some things in this past year that other people have had to go through the same thing. And when the other people went through the same thing that you went through, that some of them tried to take their own life. Some of them fell into the pit of depression. But you are still here. And I'm so glad you don't look like whatever it is that you've had to go through. And it doesn't matter what you've gone through, you still have a praise, because the stretch wasn't to destroy you, but the stress was to bless you. Do I have anybody up in here who's going through a little some? Somebody just scream stretch. Stretch, you're being stretched in every situation. I don't know if this commercial is here in Carolina or not, but in Texas they have this little commercial where there's a young boy. I think he's advertising some kind of cleaning product. And the young boy's in the bathroom. He's standing beside the commode. And he's trying to get his belt off. Yeah. He's twisting and he's turning. He's trying to get his belt off. He's got a little situation. He all of a sudden, he screams, "Mama, we've got a situation." I believe that sometimes in life, you have little situations that causes you to be stretched. But you have to do like he did. You have to call for a higher authority who has the power to come in and sit with your situation. Again, I'm just here to talk to some people that are being stretched. You're being stretched. James 1:3-4 tells us in the New International Version, for that we're being stretched. He said, "For when your faith is stretched, for when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow." God is perfecting your ability to endure. Isaiah 3:10 say, "In the process of your endurance," it said, "tell the righteous that it shall be well with thee." Whatever you're going through, that's what I like. You're going through it. You're not stuck in it, but you're going through it. And your situation is no indication of your victory, because you're going through it. So real briefly, if you will, just look at the book of Mark with me. The book of Mark, as you all know, has been suggested that the purpose of the book of Mark is to primarily be evangelistic. It looks, when you look at the book of Mark, the gospel of the book of Mark, and you know this, is a historical narrative that set forth a representative picture of the person and the work of Jesus Christ. The book itself, when you look at the book of Mark, it reminds me of my own personal journey, because the book of Mark is filled with drama. The book of Mark is filled with action. The book of Mark has internal and external storms in it. There are losses throughout the book of Mark, but also miracles in the book of Mark are always connected with some definite human need, just as our text depicts tonight. It talks about a miracle that's connected with a human need. I heard you when you talked about your miracle tonight. I'm so glad that we have a miracle sitting right in the midst of us. And if you shame the devil and tell the truth, you are a miracle in action. Because if it had not been for the miraculous power of Jesus Christ. So in our text here, Jesus entered into a synagogue where there's a man who had a withered hand. His hand was not functioning properly. There are things in our lives. It never says what caused his hand to be withered, but there are a lot of us that are dealing with withered experiences. Things that have gone sour on us, things that have decayed on us, things that are not properly functioning as they should. So they sit and they watched Jesus to see whether or not Jesus would heal him on the Sabbath day so that they might accuse Jesus. Now, when we're talking about they, we're talking about the Pharisees. And it was even said that the Pharisees perhaps planted the crippled man in the synagogue. Check that out. You have to be careful of people that plant things around you. People that try and set you up. You testifying about your deliverance. You're testifying about your breakthrough. And people are setting you up just to see if you hold fast to the profession of your faith without wavering, for he is faithful. Do I have anybody in here? You know they tried to set you up. You said God is going to bless me with a car, and they set you up and wouldn't even invite you to ride, but that's all right. Said perhaps they said that. We have to know the Pharisees. The Pharisees were a group of people that could not get along with Jesus. Somebody said that the Pharisees are not fair, you see. Yeah, so the Pharisees, when you look at it, the Pharisees are like some of the Pharisees that are in our churches in 21st century. Because the Pharisees were about works making you righteous. Get that? About works making you righteous. And we spent so much time on trying to get people to perfect work, so that their work would make them holy, or their work would make them righteous. They tried, the Pharisees said, that if you do enough good deeds to outweigh the bad deeds, then you could be saved, or you could be righteous. But sad thing they didn't know is that Ephesians 2:8 says, "But by grace, but by grace are you saved, and it's through faith. It's not of ourselves, but it is the gift of God." See, their intent was to set Jesus up and to say that he was breaking the law on the Sabbath day, and they were more concerned about the law than they were concerned about the soul. And if we're not careful, we're going to be more concerned about tradition than we are about ministry. God is looking for real ministry. Yeah, I told you I'm not here by popular demand. I'm not looking for a place to preach. God has blessed me. I'm here so that we can win the lost in our own houses. So we can win the lost in our own families. Before we go out, outreach, let's do some inreach to our own house and declare and decree that as for me and my house, we will serve. The Pookie is going to get saved. Shaniqua is going to be baptized. I don't know where. But it shall. Somebody just scream, stretch. Stretch, stretch. They were concerned about tradition. And if we aren't careful, we are going to spend more time on tradition than we are on reverency. And I have nothing against tradition, because check this out. Tell somebody, check this out. where there are no rules, there is no identity. You have to have boundaries. Where there are no boundaries, there is no identity. And God will, but we can't be more concerned about tradition and get ready for this. And the pastor is here, bishop is here. They can sit me down and I humbly will sit down. But if we're not careful, we're going to make what we consider new tradition. Because and we enjoyed the praise and worship singing. If I could sing like you, girl, they'd never give me the mic. I'd be singing all the time. But if we're not careful, we're going to make praise and worship just as traditional as testimony service. We have two songs before every service. We have two songs, and praise and worship is more than a song. You heard her trying to usher you. There ought to be a day in praise and worship where you don't even sing. You just want to make love to the lover of your life, the bishop of your soul. And you don't need a praise team. You don't need a praise worship. I'll praise him in my car. So when I get here, I don't need nobody to say, help me live Jesus. Tradition. So they were concerned. They were concerned about the law. How many of you know that Jesus came so that the law would be no more? So that the law would be no more. And what Jesus did is Jesus saw the man with his hand. And he saw it immediately. I come to tell someone tonight as I hurry through this text that Jesus sees you where you are. I'll tell you a little something about religion. Religion makes you believe that in order for Jesus to see you or in order for Jesus to come to your rescue, you have to be in the mountain. We tell people all the time, get up, get on up there, and we act as if God is only the God of the mountain. But what I learned, again, I'm not into religion, I'm into relationship. And there are days I'm not on the mountain. I don't care how saved, how sanctified, and I'm not backsliding, I love the Lord, but there are days when I'm in the valley. Do I have any reason? I told you I didn't come here for no church. I came here for an awakening of the Holy Ghost. I have some real people up in here that'll say I had some valley days. I've had some valley days. But the thing I like about my valley days is that he doesn't leave me by myself. In the valley, the psalmist say, yay. Psalm 23, yay. Though I walk, and I might be in the valley, but I'm not drowning in the valley. I'm walking through the valley. Yay, though I walk through, and I'm not just walking, but I'm going through a little something right now. I'm not going to always be here, but give me a chance to experience my valley experience, because if I never had a problem, how can I tell you that God sorry. They say, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Woo! The shadow. Somebody scream the shadow. The shadow of death. It's not even death. It's just a shadow. Woo! Being an old country girl, being a country girl from Great Water, Texas, in the nighttime when you had to, this is when you had to go home. When the sunlight was going, when the light was coming on. Don't let the light catch you out. I know y'all, you knew people. This old school stuff. Yeah. But I would be running sometime from my shadow, and I would try to catch up with my shadow. The thing about my shadow is that my shadow was always larger than me. I come to tell somebody tonight, whatever that thing is, the image of the thing is larger than the reality, because the shadow was larger. But the thing I liked about the shadow is that there can never be a shadow if there's not a light. In order to have a shadow, you got to have a light. And if I'm in the valley and there's a shadow, there's Jesus, is the light of the world, and he walks with me. Tell somebody, excuse me, I'm being stretched. stretch, 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 stretch. Being stretched. Being stretched. So they saw him. Jesus saw him. And Jesus sees you right where you are. And he said unto the man which had the withered hand, who were bringing it in, he said, stretch out your hand. That thing blessed me. Faith without works is dead. According to your faith, so be it unto you. If you have the faith the size of the chickens or the mustard seed, you don't have to climb a mountain. Your days of mountain climbing are over because God has given you power and authority to speak unto the mountain. So there are some things that you have to put in action. You have to activate that is on the inside of you. For out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. And God has given you kingdom authority to use his word. He said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word will last forever. And I honor my word. So he gives you power and authority to use his word. And I just believe that the man with the withered hand, when he heard Jesus say, stretch out your hand, he didn't do it with hesitation, but I believe he did it with revelation. I speak in this house tonight that God shall saturate you in a level of intimacy that shall give you a deeper sense of revelation, that you may get to know God for yourself. Not Big Mama's God, my dear's God, your God, the pastor's God, but that I may know him in the power of his resurrection in the fellowship of his suffering. I want to have koinonia. I want to have koinonia with him. I want to have fellowship. So he stretched forth his hand, and I'm bringing it in. That when he stretched forth his hand, the blessing preceded the stretch. Yeah. The blessing came after the stretch. And because this is your season to receive the blessing of the stretch, there are just some things I want you to keep in mind as you get ready to receive the blessing of the stretch. First thing, according extracted from this text, that you have to remember, if you are going to be the recipient of the blessings of the stretch, you have to keep in mind that opposition precedes opportunity. You will be stretched. You will be tested. You will be tried. 1 Peter 1:6-8 says that the trying of your faith, being much more precious than that of silver or gold, that perish of might be tried in the fire, and when it's all over you, it may come out in glory, honor, and praise at the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. It talks about the trying of your faith, that the genuineness of your faith, the test comes to get rid of faith. God doesn't want you operating in a level of faith. So he sends trials and tribulations to create authenticity of your faith, because we realize we can be anyone we want to be when things are going well. It is said that the character of an individual is not defined during his good days, but the character of an individual is defined when you're going through. That's when the real you come out. So God sends some of us through the water, some of us through the flood, but God has not designed a test that's going to take you out. So he says to this, opposition precedes opportunity. So when oppositions come, he says in 1 Peter 4:12, think it not strange. Listen to the Amplified Bible that says it like this: beloved, do not be amazed or bewildered at the fiery ordeal which is taking place to test your quality. Let's stop right there. The purpose of the test is to define the quality of a thing. If you want to know how sturdy the foundation is, you test it. General Motors is that smart. Before they send out a vehicle, it doesn't matter what model, what make the vehicle is, what they intentionally will do is take that model and run it into the wall. They'll take that model and run it over nails. They will take that model and have a head-on collision because they want to know if it can endure when it gets in your hand. See, whatever you're going through, it didn't come on its own. It had to get God's permission. When we talk about Job, Pastor, when we talk about Job, when we talk about Job, when we talk about Job, Job never volunteered for the test. Nowhere in the text did it say Job volunteered for the test, but God recommended Job. The hell you're going through is because God recommended. Being stretched because God, let me hurry, because God recommended you, and he knew that when it was over, you'd be all right. Point number two, and I only have three. Point number two, that when you're being stretched in order to receive the blessing, point number two, you must learn to sustain the fire within. In other words, you have to keep the fire burning within you. When you're going through, you can't be real. Sometimes the little flames start flickering. Because the enemy will come in and try and make you think that the doctor didn't call you because the report was bad, or that you're not going to get that promotion or that job, or you're not going to elevate into the new levels of spiritual intimacy that you're looking for. So you have to, sometime, and the church forgets to tell us this a lot, sometime you have to encourage yourself. You have to speak over your own life. You have to keep, don't have any real people helping here. You have to keep the fire burning on the inside. You're looking for somebody to call, but they're so busy and focused in on your outward appearance, dictating them what they can prophesy about. I don't need you to look at me and come up with a prophecy. I need you to design in the spiritual realm. Well, so you have to encourage yourself. So Ephesians 5:19 says it like this. It says, speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs and singing and making melody in your heart. You have to sustain the fire within. You have to pull out a song. Yeah. And I'm not saying that you have to know the entire song. Some. You may not know the entire 23rd. Lord, my shepherd said, I want maybe the light and green pastor. But this day, all I can get out of the Lord is. I can't even think of the other sentence. All I know is the Lord is. The Lord, I encourage myself by saying the Lord is. So I speak to myself in psalms and in hymns and every now and then. I know we're not into hymnals. I know that. But every now and then, you need to pull out one of those hymnals and encourage you. Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the cart before? Why should my heart feel lonely and lost? His eye is on the sparrow and I. He watches over me. Yeah. Sometimes you have to pull out. Then I'm going to do this. Then I'm going to hurry up. And then it talks about spiritual songs. So somebody said, what is a spiritual song? Well, this is my big mama told me this. She didn't write it or record it. But big mama said that a spiritual song is a song that's birthed in your spirit when you're going through. Have you ever been going through something and a song comes up in your spirit? And then sometimes when that thing is over, you can't even remember what the song was. Because the song... Somebody say, yeah. That's only because that song was... That song resonated in your spirit for that particular time. So you encourage yourself, in Psalms and Hymns, and then 1 Thessalonians 5 from the easy to read Bible said, always be thrilled with joy. Never stop praying, and whatever happens, just always be thankful. And I want to put this while you're encouraging yourself. This is your challenge in encouraging yourself to hang in there. Listen, stick with the routine. Stick with the routine. And the routine will keep you until passion kicks in. Stay with the routine. You get up every morning and routinely you stay with it until passion kicks in. Stay with it until there's a hunger and a drive and you're able to encourage yourself to hang on in there, because the blessings of the Lord are upon you and the blessings of the Lord would be upon you. So encourage yourself in psalm and hymns and spiritual songs. And then the last thing I'm going to say, because you've been stretched and we are a sanctified church, I need you to get ready for a move of the Holy Ghost this season like never before. This is the Acts 1 and 8 season, where it says you shall receive power, exousia, dunamis power. Let's rest. Let's park right here. It said that you shall receive power. You shall receive delegated authority. That's what power is, delegated authority. Well, where did I get the authority from? The Holy Ghost have come upon you. The Holy Ghost is here to arrest somebody. In spite of what you are being stretched to, you have to be able to recognize the Holy Ghost. Look at somebody and say, recognize the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost is not an it. The Holy Ghost is not a something. But the Holy Ghost is an equal member of the Trinitarian. We are Trinitarians. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost are eternal in coexistence. Y'all taught me that the Holy Ghost didn't just show up in the New Testament. It didn't just show up in Acts 1 and 8. But if you back that thing up to Genesis, around the first chapter, it was the Holy Spirit that played an active role in the creation. Ooh. Look at your neighbor and say, Holy Ghost, arrest me tonight. It was the Holy Ghost that showed up in Genesis 1 and 2, where it said the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. But God speaks of the Holy Ghost when he talks in Genesis 1 and 26. When he said, let us. See, you can't defend what you don't know. And if we don't teach our children the gift of the Holy Ghost, when they are in opposition, contagious situations, instead of being able to defend the Holy Ghost, they come intimidated by the naysayers. But if we teach them the power of the Holy Ghost, let them know that in the New Testament, that the Apostle John referred to the Trinity as the Trinity is not deciphered in the Bible. The word Trinity is not in the Bible, but John spoke of it when he said these three are one and these three agree with one. I believe that we need to teach our children that we believe that the regeneration by the Holy Ghost is absolutely essential for personal salvation. We believe that the Holy Ghost didn't just show up, but it was early one morning, just about the break of day. I believe the Holy Ghost fell on me. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, do you have the Holy Ghost? Tell them, if you have. That's the way we say, if you got it, you ought to show some signs. if you got it, somebody ought to know that you got the Holy Ghost. If you have it, the wounded ought to be healed. The sick need to be well. Deliverance is coming out of your house. When it's all over, the Holy Ghost power will give you bounce back power. Look at somebody's name. My hand was withered, but when I heard the voice of the Holy Ghost say, stretch out on His word, stretch out on His anointing, stretch out on His power, I got victory in my home, victory on my job. Say yes, say yes. If you know that you've been stretched, we're getting ready to close. But I double dare you to give God a stretch of praise. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, you don't know what I've been going through. You don't know what's been pulling me apart. You don't know what I've been praying about. But neighbor, excuse me while I give God a stretch of praise. I'm gonna praise Him like it's already done. Praise Him like the victory's won. Praise Him like my children are saved. Praise Him. Praise Him. Praise Him.
Thank you.
evil. Somebody scream, boomerang!
I'm praying about the yoke breakthrough. I'm praying about the yoke.
church. Come on, come on up here. Come on. Yeah. I need you to praise him for some of the mothers that can't praise him like you praise him. Get ready. Do it on behalf, brother. The seed of alive people. Get ready. One, two, three. That's for the mothers. Somebody says it's gonna rain on your head. If you will, just lay your hands on somebody. You don't have time to pray for everyone, but lay your hands on someone. was raised by my grandmother. And my grandmother had a tin roof, like a T-I-N roof. Y'all don't know anything about that. Some mornings, Big Mama would come in and say, y'all get up, get up, get up. It's raining outside. We said, Big Mama, how you know? We haven't even been outside yet. She said, I hear. I may not see it, but I may not see my miracle, but I hear the footsteps. Oh! My promise is about to be fulfilled. I hear the footsteps. He stretched me so he could bless me. While you're holding that hand or laying that hand on the person, just begin to pray for them. You have power working in you. You are anointed. You are chosen. You're justified. Justified in faith. Pray for them as if it's your last time. Come on, we're going to get out of here in the next 5 minutes, but pray. Let that oil in you flow in them. Let the anointing that is at work in you flow in them. Let it flow, 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 let it flow. They're too involved in it. They can't pray for it like you can. They've been wrestling with it too long, but you're not in it. You can pray, 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 pray. Two are better than one. Two are better than one. Two are better than one. If they ask anything in my name, will I do? That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's what this AIM convention is about. That's it. While you're holding that hand, just lift that hand up. Don't let it go. Lift it up. Lift it up. Because sometimes people need you to just lift them up. 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 Lift them up, lift them up, lift them up, lift them up. Lift them up, lift them up, lift them up. Lift them up, there's a breaking, there's a breaking, there's a breaking, there's a breaking. I'm on divine assignment, ain't nobody playing church. I'm not just here to be here. You're in surgery, you're in surgery.